A very good morning to all of you. Today's topic is about urban growth analysis by calculating matrices to quantify the urban sprawl. Myself, Dr. Varun Narayan Mishra, working here as an assistant professor. Today we will discuss to calculate matrices that will be helpful to quantify the urban sprawl. In the previous classes, we have discussed urban sprawl mapping, urban sprawl modeling, different types of urban growth classes, and every factors, driving factors, responsible factors for urban growth. Now we are going to see today's class about the calculation of several matrices that can be useful to quantify or to identify or to calculate, you can say, to calculate the urban sprawl. So today's topic is urban growth analysis by calculating urban matrices to quantify the urban sprawl. Okay, so this is a kind of the today's lecture is about the case study type lecture in which we have analyzed the change in the urban spatial structure over 10-year period for a global sample of 120 cities. This project was implemented over the period of 10 years for the major 120 cities of the world. So the entire project having two phases. The phase one is about the acquiring or deriving the necessary data set. And in this phase two, the further development in the matrices that will be very much useful to quantify and characterize the spatial structure of the cities. Okay, and in phase two, we will create some maps to facilitate the qualitative assessment of the urban structure also. So before starting first, so what was the objective of phase one? The phase one objective was to select some stratified global sample of 120 cities with population over 1 lakh. Okay, then we have to classify urban land cover features for each city at two time periods. First time period is around is year 1990 and second period is 2000. And in third step, we have to derive preliminary matrices for characterizing the urban development at time T1 and time T2. Okay, so first one is that land cover derivation. Land cover derived from the Landsat satellite images. As we all know that Landsat satellite images are freely available and widely used for different land use land cover practices. So land cover data sets of two different dates, that is 1990 and 2000, was derived by using multi-temporal Landsat data sets, and the entire image was categorized or was classified into three categories, that is major categories urban, water, and there is a third category, that is other. Other includes any kind of land use land cover category. It includes agricultural land, it may include the vegetation, it may include fallow land, it may include wasteland, anything. So the entire land, the entire image of two time period has been categorized into three categories: urban, water, and other. Okay, so the classification of the built up pixels using Landsat images, as we know that Landsat city satellites were started in 1972, and since 1972 Landsat city satellites are continuously providing the multispectral satellite images. That was a joint project between NASA and USGS. Okay, so for this work, two sensor data sets, the data sets acquired by two different sensors, that is Landsat 4-5 and Landsat 7, the TM sensor of the Landsat 4 and 5 and the ETM plus sensor of the Landsat 7 was used to classify the images of that area. Okay, so these are some specifications of the Landsat TM and Landsat ETM plus sensors. You know, you see here for Landsat TM, we are having different bands: blue, green, red, near infrared, mid infrared, then mid infrared 2, and panchromatic is also there for Landsat 7 ETM. TM and ETM plus is only having difference that in ETM we are having additional band, that is panchromatic band. Okay, so in ETM plus there are total 8 spectral bands, and in TM there are total 7 spectral bands including one thermal infrared band. Okay, so these are some specifications of the TM and ETM plus sensors that was used in this study. So it is also important to see the spectral reflectance or spectral response of various land use land cover classes. So this is the graph, this is the figure showing the spectral response at different wavelength intervals for different land surface features like agricultural soil, okay, the fresh concrete, there are dry vegetation, bare soil, water bodies are there, sand, then aged concrete, grass, asphalt. As we are talking about urban area, so in urban area, there may be some concrete surface, there may be some asphalt surface, there may be some aged concrete. So you see here, every earth surface feature may have different spectral reflectance, different spectral behavior at different wavelength intervals. Okay, so this is very well known to you, the agricultural land or the vegetation related features reflect more in an IR in comparison to the other bands. Okay, whereas water bodies absorb all the electromagnetic radiation coming from the sun, which interact with the water bodies. Okay, and remaining other features may have varying spectral response. At some places they have high reflectance, at some places or at some wavelength intervals they are having low reflectance. So we need to have accurate, or we need to have a good information about the spectral response or spectral pattern of different earth surface features. Okay, so the classification of the urban area, that is, you can say the built-up pixels, have been done in the ADAS imaging software. Landsat scenes were required for each study site for two different time period, 1990-2000. Software was used, ADAS imaging. Okay, the scenes have been clipped using the preliminary set of administrative district boundaries. Okay, before doing any kind of classification, before doing any kind of analysis, we have to clip or we have to subset our study area from the entire scene. Okay, and unsupervised classification method was used for classifying the image into urban and non-urban classes. As we know that classification methods are of two types, supervised and unsupervised method. So unsupervised method was used in this study, and unsupervised method having two types, ISO data clustering and k-means clustering. So here the ISO data unsupervised method was used for classifying the satellite images into urban and non-urban classes. The full form of ISO data is iterative self-organizing data analysis. So the data assigned to the homogeneous classes is based on the spectral properties, and ideally we can say that the classes related to a single land cover class having certain type of land cover, they may have similar spectral response. So in such kind of unsupervised classification methods, there may be the problems because of the shadows and clouds, because they are having almost similar kind of spectral, you can have the similar kind of spectral properties, or shadow may have also may be problematic for identifying a specific feature. Okay, so it is important to use the cloud free images when we are going for the classification and other analysis of the satellite images. Okay, so user identifies the land cover type that is best corresponds to the each ISO data classes. We need to identify the major land use land cover classes. Here we have identified three major land use land cover classes, urban, water, and you can say non-other classes. Manually, we can edit the classification errors by using on-screen digitization and recording. If during the classification process or after getting the classification result, if you are finding that there are some classification errors, so you can use recording option to manually reduce the errors caused by the mixing of different pixels. Okay, so record edited classification image to the classes urban and non-urban classes. So entire image was classified into urban and non-urban classes. So this is the satellite image, this is the Landsat image of that area in false color composite, having NIR, mid-infrared, and green band. Okay, after performing the unsupervised classification and recording, the entire image is classified into urban and non-urban images. So these red patches are showing urban area, and other color is showing non-urban images, non-urban classes. Okay, water has moderately low reflectance in the visible band. As we know that water is not having high reflectance because most of the energy coming from the sun is absorbed by the water bodies. So there may be very low reflectance in the infrared band. So water index is in the following ratio, that high water index value is equal to water, and we can record the water index image into two classes, that is water and non-water. So the entire image will be classified into water and non-water categories. Okay, so this is the image, this is the figure showing the classified product having water and non-water classes. Water is having low reflectance in visible and near infrared portion. It is very much easy to, it is very easy to identify our water bodies using the satellite images in NIR band. Okay, so using this property of the spectral response, using the spectral response property of water bodies, we can easily categorize the image into water and non-water categories. Okay, moving to the next slide. Okay, now after getting the information about the urban and non-urban, then water and non-water classes, we can combine these two classified maps using overlay analysis to create the final classified map having urban area, water area, and other area. So here in the final figure, you can have three categories. Red one is urban, blue is water bodies, and that brownish color type of part is having other classes. They may have different classes, including agriculture, vegetation, fallow, wasteland, anything. Maybe they are into that other class. So primarily our focus was on the urban and water class of that study area. Okay, so this is the another part. This is another city that can be, that was selected for this project, for this study. This is the Bacolod area of the Philippines. It is also showing three classes, urban, water, and other. Okay, so this is another study site used for this project. Okay, in the same way, the entire mechanism was repeated for this city also. We have to first clip the administrative boundary, administrative district, then population data were attributed to the administrative districts, and districts defines the outer perimeter of the cities and provide the population data. Okay, phase one, they are also having required to have the slope information. So for getting this slope information, we have used subtle radar topography mission SRTM data. SRTM data is a sensor. SRTM is a sensor that provides the digital elevation model. So by processing digital elevation model, we can easily calculate the slope map of the study area. Okay, so the maximum slope that is defined as the slope value between below 90% of the urban area exists. Okay, so this is the slope map of the study area after processing. By utilizing the digital elevation model of that study area, we can easily calculate the slope information of that area. So this is the figure showing the slope information of that area. Okay, this is the table showing the maximum and average value of the slope. So you can see here the maximum slope is around 2.55 degree. Okay, and the count, the pixel count is around 4010 Hz. Means the total, out of total pixels of the image, 4108 pixels are having the slope value of 2.5. okay, so the maximum slope is the slope value at the 90th percentile. The most of the slope area is covered by the pixels around 4108. Now in the second phase, after maintaining, after classifying the data sets, after classifying the satellite images into different categories, urban, water, and other categories, now second phase is very important. In this phase, now we are going to calculate different matrices that can be used to measure the specific aspect of the urban spatial structure. Okay, so these matrices are very important. These metrics can be used to identify, or you can use, it can be used to quantify the urban sprawl. Okay, okay, so sprawl manifestation, like you can see at a given point of time, the sprawl is manifested in the built-up area. Sprawl means multiple urban core, then ribbon or strip development. There may be the scatter development, or there may be the fragmented and unusable open space. manifestation are quantified within the following matrices: main core, secondary core, urban fringe. The entire urban growth may be categorized. The entire urbanization or urban sprawl area is categorized into following matrices: main core, secondary core, urban fringe, ribbon development, and scattered development. In sprawling cities, the low density developments such as ribbon and scatter are expected to increase the increase over the time. So this is the sprawl manifestation matrices. That is a derivation of a matrix which is known as sprawl manifestation matrix. It is known as urbanness. The name of the matrix is known as urbanness. Urbanness is the percentage of the neighborhood that is built up. The neighborhood is around 1 square kilometer of the circle around that pixel. Okay, so urbanness tells us the percentage of the neighborhood that is built up. Okay, so this is the flow chart showing how we can use the urban matrices, how we can use urban information for calculating different matrices. We are having the urban area by classifying the satellite images. Out of all the urban area, more than 50%, if it is having more than 50% of the urban area, then it is known as urbanness. If it is between 30 to 50%, and the less than 50%, so the entire urban area, the entire built up area was categorized into three categories, into three groups. More than 50%, one is between 30 to 50%, and second one, third one is less than 30%. Okay, so if it is having more than 50%, the largest continuous group of the pixels, and it is also considered as the main core. All other groups are considered as the secondary core. If the built up area or the number of pixels in the built up class is between 30 to 50%, then it is known as the fringe. And if it is less than 30%, okay, then it is considered as the linear semi-continuous group, that is known as ribbon, and all other groups are considered as the scatter. So we are having five matrices: main core, secondary core, fringe, ribbon, and scatter. These are the manifestation matrices that can be used to quantify the urban sprawl. Okay, so this is the figure showing sprawl manifestation for the Bangkok. It's a major city of the Thailand. You can see here different colors: main urban area, secondary urban core, urban fringe, ribbon, and scatter. Five categories of the urban sprawl has been categorized for that urban area. You can see by it different color. So main urban core is shown by the brown color. The secondary urban areas, urban cores are considered as red color. Urban fringe are considered, are shown by this yellow color, then ribbon and scatter. So in this way, you can have the information about different sprawl manifestation of a urban area or urban city. Okay, so this is the statistics. This is the values of different sprawl manifestation matrices for the Bangkok and Minneapolis. These are two major cities. Okay, you can see here the T1, T2 are the two time period. One time period is around 1994 and 2000 for Bangkok, and for Minneapolis, the T1 is 1992 and T2 is 2001. So for built up area only, when we have calculated five matrices: main core, secondary core, the urban fringe, ribbon, and scatter, and it is calculated in terms of square kilometer for two major cities, Bangkok and Minneapolis, you can have different statistics. And after subtracting T2 from T1, we can have the annual increase or decrease in the in different matrices. Okay, so that is annual delta T for two major cities, Bangkok and Minneapolis. You can see here there may be some positive changes or there may be some negative changes over the time period of T1 and T2. That is, T1 is for T1 is year 1994, T2 is 2002 for Bangkok, T1 is 1992 and T2 2001 for Minneapolis. Okay, so new development classification. Over the period of time, the sprawl is manifested in new developments that either extend the outward from the existing development, that is known as leapfrog sprawl. Okay, leapfrog means if there is a sprawl over beyond the existing development area, beyond the existing developed area, if there is a sprawl, then this is known as leapfrog, that is away from the existing development. So new development in any built up area added between the two time period, that is T1 and T2. The classification of the new development area is based on the location that is related to the T1 urban area or T2 urban area. Okay, so new development means infill. Infill is a new development that is occurring within the T1 urbanized open space. It increases contiguity of the built up area by filling the urbanized open space. Okay, T1 is the built up pixels in gray and infill in red, means the existing built up area, the existing built up pixels are shown in gray color, and the newly developed urban area that is considered as the infill is shown here as a red color. So this is the way in which we can measure the newly developed urban area or the new development in a city or in an urban area. Okay, extension. So extension is a new non-infill development that is intersecting the T1 urban footprint that extends outwards the previous development. Okay, here T1 is the urbanized area is gray and extension is the orange. Existing urban area is shown in the gray color, and this extended urban area, the extension or the urban area which is extended over the period of time is shown here as a orange color. So you can see here urban area is extended beyond the boundary, having shown as a orange color. So this is the way in which we can also study the extension of the existing urban area that can be used as a new developed area or new development in that area. Leapfrog is a new development or new urban area that is not intersecting with the existing urban area. Okay, existing urban area is shown in gray color. Okay, and if the new urban area is developed that is not intersecting, that is not close to the existing urban area, this kind of development is known as leapfrog. Okay, so no contiguity with the previous developed area, and it has the greatest effect on the growth of the urban footprint and fragmentation of the open land. So this is the way in which we can study the newly developed area which is not in connection or which is not in the direct relation with the existing urban area or previously developed urban area. There is no interaction between the existing urban area and newly developed area. So such kind of development, such kind of newly developed urban area is known as leapfrog. Okay, so by integrating the information of infill, extension and leapfrog, we can have such kind of map. Here red color is showing infill, means newly developed area. Extension is showing the extended or the urban area which is extended beyond the city boundary. And leapfrog are some of the clusters or some of the urbanized area which is away from the existing urban area, and they are not having any interaction with the existing urban area. That is known as leapfrog. And the gray color is showing the existing footprint. Okay, existing urban area is shown here as a gray color. So in this figure we are having to have the information about the new development or newly urbanized area over the period of 1994 to 2002 in Bangkok of Thailand. Okay, so how we can attribute the urban sprawl? Urban sprawl or urbanization can be attributed, can be quantifiable for each city. For that we need to apply different matrices that was developed to describe each attribute. Matrix is each set tend to be highly correlated. We identified four attributes of urban spatial structure that are commonly associated with the sprawl. Okay, the first one is limitless. The first attribute is a limitless. It is used for the land to be considered as urban depends on the issue of interest. Whether it is impervious surface alone for the water body or heavily impacted upon the land as well as the impervious surfaces. So here we can have three measurements of the urban extent that corresponds to the different perception of what constitutes a city: built up area, urbanized area and urban footprint. These three are important measures of any urbanization or any urban growth existing built up area, urbanized area, or urban footprint. Okay. So for applying limitless urban extent, we have a landscape image, then we have identified into built up area, open space, then under open space, now we have categorized into two classes, urbanized open space and peripheral open space. If there is urbanness is greater than 50%, or if the peripheral open space is less than 100 meter from the existing urban area, then it will be considered as the urban footprint. So urban footprint is important to identify for measuring the limitless urban extent. It's a kind of matrix. Okay, urban extent for the Bangkok. Okay, here you see red one is showing the built up area, yellow color is showing the urbanized open space, the green color is showing the peripheral open space and water and open space. Okay, this is the urban extent for the Bangkok over the period of time 1994 to 2002. So this is the table showing the urban extension matrix for Bangkok and Minneapolis for two time period, T1 and T2, for different matrices: urbanized area, urbanized OS, urbanized footprint, peripheral OS, and affected OS. So this is the way we can have the information about different urban extent matrices, and we can also calculate the changes in the urban matrices over the period of time. Now moving to the next slide. Yeah, second attribute is about the declining population density. The population densities are expected to decline over the period of time in sprawling cities. Okay, the population densities that is measured for three types of the urban extent. One is, now third attribute is non-compactness of the urban area. The compactness of a sprawling city is expected to decline over time due to the leapfrogging and low density development. We measure the compactness of the urbanized area, the matrices, based on the assumption that the circle is the most compact shape that is possible for a given area. So compactness matrices are normalized and ranges from 0 to 1, with higher value indicates more compact shape. If the urbanization is having compact, it is having high density. Okay, so we measure the compactness of the urbanized area. This matrix is based on the assumption that a circle is the most compact shape possible for a given area. Okay, so for that, for that attribute, we measure the proximity index. The proximity index is based on the average distance of all points in the urbanized area to the center of gravity, centroid of the urbanized area. For that, we will normalize the average distance to the centroid of the equal area circle with radius. That is a circle with an area equal to that of the urbanized area. D is equal to 2/3 into *. So this is the figure showing the compactness, or if you can say it is showing the proximity index. This black circle, this black is the centroid or the central area of any urbanized area, center of any urbanized area. And the other gray color is showing the urbanized area. So we need to study the proximity to the center of the urban area, so that if we are very close to the center of the urban area, so it's more compact, it's more compact urbanization. Okay, this is the way we can see the, we can measure the compactness of the urban area. Okay, so for measuring the compactness, we use the cohesion index. The cohesion index is based on the average distance between all possible pairs of the points in the urbanized area, and it is calculated using the equation D is equal to 0.9054 into R. okay, so urbanized area pixel in a gray, that is having sample point in the black. Urbanized area is showing in the gray color, and the sample point means these are the center of different urban, these are the central pixel of different urbanized part of the study area. That is black. So it can be also used to measure the compactness of the urban area. That is done, that can be done using the cohesion index. Cohesion index measures the average distance between all the pairs of the points with the equal area circle with radius R. Now moving to the next slide. So how to measure the compactness? The compactness and the constant compactness indices. There are two indices, the compactness index and constant compactness index. So the compactness index measures the fraction of the shape area that is within an equal area circle that is centered at the shape centroid. And the constrained compactness index is showing an area that is a fraction of the shape area that is within the net equal area circle that is centered at this shape centroid. So this is the figure. In this figure, you can see this circle is showing the compactness of the urban area. The urban area within this city, the urban area within this circle is considered as the compact urbanized area or compactness. Okay. And the net equal area circle has a buildable area that is excluding the water and excessive slope equal to the urbanized area. Okay, so measuring the compactness is very important to see how the urbanization is there and how much density of that urbanized area is there. Okay, that can easily tell us the information about the compactness of that urban area. Now moving to the next slide. There is another attribute, that is attribute 4. Attribute 4 means the non-contiguity of the built-up area and the fragmentation of the open land. This attribute tells us how the sprawling cities are typically expected to become less contiguous over the time period, over the period of study, while the adjacent open land becomes increasingly fragmented. The contiguity metrics are based on the built-up area, and it is having the higher values for all the matrices that can show the lower contiguity of the built-up area and greater fragmentation of the open space. So this fourth attribute for urban sprawl is that we need to see how the sprawling cities are expected to become the less contiguous over the period of time while with adjoining open land. Open land are becoming increasingly over the time period. So how the sprawling cities are expected to become less contiguous while the adjacent open space becomes increasingly fragmented. Here we will see the contiguity and fragmentation. These are two important terms here, contiguity and the fragmentation. Okay, so openness. For that, openness is the index that is having the average openness of all the built-up pixels. Openness is the fraction of the open land within a 1 square kilometer neighborhood around a given built-up pixel that is the complement of the urbanness. Its value ranges from 0 to 1. So for calculating the openness, we use the formula which is given here. Openness is equal to 1 square kilometer minus 0.2 square kilometer upon 1 square kilometer. So first we need to identify a boundary in the form of circle, and we will calculate the number of pixels in that circle. We will calculate the number of pixels in that circle. The total, this circle is showing the area of around 0.2 square kilometer, and under this area we are able to having the total number of built-up pixels around 252. Okay, so by getting this information, we can calculate the openness by having the number of pixels in 1 square kilometer range, then number of pixels in 0.2 square kilometer range, and the entire area of 1 square kilometer. So this is the openness index. It tells us, it provides us the information about the average delta pixels in a specific area or in a specific circle in a specific region. This is the openness. Open space contiguity. So the open space contiguity is an index. This index is used to calculate the fraction of the built-up pixel that are cardinally adjacent to at least one open space pixel. Okay, what is the fraction of a built-up pixel that are adjacent to at least one open space pixel is known as open space contiguity index. It can be used to calculate using a neighborhood operation. Neighborhood operation can be done on the central pixel and its surrounding pixels. This kind of operation is known as neighborhood operation, when we select a central pixel and then select some neighborhood pixels, and we run the neighborhood operation. So by applying this neighborhood operation, we can easily have the information. We can easily calculate the open space contiguity index. Its value ranges from 0 to 1. 0 means less open space contiguity, and 1 means highest open space contiguity. So these are some indexes that are very much useful for attributing the urban sprawl. Here in this figure, you can see the total built up pixels are shown in gray color and open space pixels in the white color. Built up pixels are in the gray color and open pixels are in the white color. Now we will select any of the gray pixel or any of the white pixel, and then again select the neighborhood pixels of around that gray or white pixel, and then we will run the neighborhood operation to see how the fraction of the built up pixel is adjacent to the at least one is open space pixel. So this can give you the value between ranging from 0 to 1, and it will tell us how the open space contiguity is there, how a built up area is adjacent to a open space pixel, how a built up pixel is near to a open space pixel. So there may be the chance for the further development, there may be the chance for the further construction in that urban area. Now moving to the next slide. Open space fragmentation is an index that is the ratio of the affected open land to the built up area, and it is affected the open land that includes the urbanized open space and the peripheral open space, and its values are greater than the 0. Okay, it's a ratio of the affected open land to the built up land, and its values should always be greater than the 0. 0 means high ratio of the affected open land and the built up land. This is the open space fragmentation, and the index is known as open space fragmentation index. Okay, urban growth analysis tool. There is a tool which is written in the Python, which is a kind of Python script. It can work with the ArcGIS software. It is executable through the Python or ArcGIS toolbox. So there is a tool developed in Python as a Python script that is known as Urban Growth Analysis Tool, UGAT, and it can also work with the ArcGIS extension. UGAT performs all the analysis needed to derive the matrices and create the GIS layers. Data is input into the tool via a table. Table may contain the data for any number of cities. UGAT will run the analysis for each city listed in the table. So this is a tool that can be worked with the ArcGIS, and for the input into the data, this tool supports the input data that will be in the form of table. The table may have the data of any number of cities. UGAT will run the analysis for each city listed in the table. UGAT performs all the analysis that is needed to derive the matrices and create the GIS layer. For calculating such kind of matrices, for doing such kind of analysis, we can use UGAT tool. Okay, so this is the interface. This is the figure showing the UGAT, Urban Growth Analysis Tool, inbuilt in ArcGIS toolbox. Okay, this is the way you can use it for further analysis and application. And now for this Urban Growth Analysis Tool, we can also have different GIS layer. It supports different GIS layer to calculate the matrices. That can be very much useful for quantitatively or qualitatively describe the attributes associated with the urban sprawl. When we are going to study the urban sprawl over the time period of T1 and T2, T1, T2 may be two different time periods, and this it can be analyzed by the changes in the urban spatial structure between the two time periods. So this tool is basically analyze the following input data that is having two time period land cover data, a city boundary shape file, the slope grid, and the central business district shape file, the input values that is required for that, and for both time period T1 and T2, different land cover dates, maximum slopes, and the population. So we can also incorporate some of the you can say some of the socio-economic data sets, including population data set or population density. We may also have some literacy rate. We can also have some male female ratio, and other socio-economic data sets can also be integrated this urban growth analysis tool for getting better information, for providing much more information about the matrices that can be used to quantify the urban growth over the time period of T1 and T2. Okay, so this is the way. So now the concluding remark for today's lecture is about in this kind of study, we can have the urban growth analysis tool. We can use urban growth analysis tool. The future papers will provide the in-depth and comprehensive discussion of the matrices developed in this project. So the matrices that is developed for this work allow the rigorous quantitative assessment of the change in the urban spatial structure over the time period. Matrices in a set tend to be highly correlated, so we need to provide some alternative way to measure the each attribute, and it is possible to use to make use of this urban growth analysis tool to perform the analysis for a large number of cities. The tool will be made available to researchers interested in applying the analysis to their own study area. Okay, so when we are talking about urban growth, or when we are talking about the urban growth analysis in terms of qualitative and quantitative measurement, so for qualitative and quantitative measurement, we can use such kind of urban growth analysis tools that can be very much practical to perform the analysis over the large number of cities at a time, so that we can have the quantitative information or qualitative information about the urban growth, urban pattern over the different time periods. So today's lecture is all about the urban growth analysis by calculating some matrices that can be helpful to quantify the urban sprawl in terms of some quantitative values or in terms of some qualitative information. Thank you very much for today's lecture. If you have any questions, then you can ask to me. Thank you.